So, you just finished your first classic run and you are now looking into Endless. Well, today we are doing an Endless guide. This is going to be all the way from how to unlock Endless all the way to some tips for finishing your first Endless run or at least go as far as you possibly can. Endless is currently capped at 5850 because of the lack of tokens. After that, the game does not work anymore. So after this video gets out, I will continue the YouTube series to reach 5850 using the archive from my stream. So feel free to tune in and watch. Note that I don't only plan to stream Pokerogue, but also Emerald Rogue at some point. The stream starts every day at 6 p.m. GMT. Now for the mod, as the name intends, there is an endless amount of floor that gets harder and harder. In this mod, there is no trainers, no rivals, no league, only wild Pokémon. The biome changes and resets every couple of floors and you can find any Pokémon. Shinies, Fusions, Legendaries, etc, etc. Defeating the boss on the 50, 100, 150 and 200 floor will give you an Egg Voucher Plus every time, and defeating the special boss on the 250th floor gives you an Egg Voucher Premium every time. This set of boss battles repeats endlessly for as long as you can continue. So in Endless mod, biomes changes every 1 to 4 waves, and how many waves you stay in a biome is actually randomly determined. Just like in Classic mod, biomes are switching according to the biome map. For example, if you are in the Factory biome, you have a 87.5% chance to get into the Plain biome and 12.5% chance to get into the Laboratory. Keep in mind that there is no map item in Endless mode, so you cannot choose where to go. Whenever the biome changes, all of your Pokémon will be returned to their Pokéballs and be healed. This also removes any stat changes, so you cannot abuse Sword Dance or any kind of Pokémon like that. It is not working anymore because you return into your Pokéball. As I said earlier, every 50 waves, you will face off against a random Paradox boss. Every 250 waves, you will face off against Eternatus, and every 1000 waves, you will face off against Eternamax Eternatus. The higher up you get in waves, the more common boss Pokémon are on waves below 10. Boss Pokémon have shields on their health that make it harder to make them faint, and they spawn using the boss tables from their respective biome. And finally, every 50 waves you complete, you will also be given a token. So tokens are items that you receive from those 50 waves completed, and they are permanent buff to the enemies or debuff to you. So you have the damage token that increases the damage of the enemy and stack to 999. You have the protection token that reduces the damage enemy take by 5% and stack to 999. Recovery token are going to heal the enemy for 3% of their max HP every turn and stack to 10. You have a full heal token, add a 10% chance to heal an enemy's status condition at the end of every turn and stack to 5. Endure token, very annoying one, add a 2.5% chance that an enemy will endure your attack and stack to 10. So they will survive a fatal hit, except if it is an OHKO move. Fusion token, add a 1% chance that a wild Pokémon will be a fusion and stack to 10. Poison token add a 10% chance to be inflicted with poison that when hit by an opponent and stack to 5. Paralyzed token add a 10% chance to be inflicted with paralysis when hit by an opponent and stack to 5. Sleep token add a 10% chance to be inflicted with sleep, annoying one as well, when hit by an opponent and stack to 5. Freeze token add a 10% chance, so you get the point, it's freeze and burn with the last two tokens. To be completely honest, the two most annoying tokens are Endure and Sleep. Sleep is going to stop your attack, so it is quite annoying. And Endure is going to stop you from just killing the enemy, which could be a problem as well. Now, let's move on to the different stages of Endless. So I'm going to split the different parts in 4 to 5 stages. It depends on you. You have the first 100 floors. So if you are testing a new potential carry, this is where you might lose your run to a weakness that you cannot deal with on your main Pokémon. I had some issues yesterday on my first journey. This is why it is always important to bring a runaway Pokémon, but more on that later. After that, you have 101 to 1000. So most of the time, if you can get past the first floors and you have a steel slash fairy type to deal with Eternatus, you should be fine until floor 1000, where Eternatus G-Max form can potentially surprise you. After that, you have from 1001 all the way to 2000 or 2500. At that point, you probably have a couple of Pokémon. You have a runaway Pokémon to escape tough fights. You have a pickup Pokémon and a main carry with all your items. And with the recent rework of tokens, most of the time you can get away with having a pretty big legendary and get all the way to 2000 or 2500. After that, we have from 2000 or from 2500 all the way to the end of the game. So the second part of Endless is done with a couple of strats, but using the same principle most of the time. You need a couple of Pokémon. There is actually some kind of checklist that I made. So you have a runaway and a pickup Pokémon that you can start ditching. So the pickup Pokémon, not the runaway Pokémon. You need a strong spliced Pokémon with some kind of ability like Sturdy and some kind of move that deals damage based on something the enemy has. It can be his move, his level, or something like this. So moves like Metal Burst, Nightshade, Seismic Toss, and build some kind of strat around it. That's your new carry. I will give you multiple examples later in the video, so don't worry about this. We are just talking about the big lines here. You need a Pokémon or a mix of Pokémon with those four moves, so Salcure, Leech Seed, Soak, and potentially Super Fang. This is your best bet to deal with the highest Eternatus fights and just the more annoying fights in the game. Again, I will explain later. You need a terrain setter and some kind of weather support. You need some kind of ability manipulation with entrainment or skill swap, or neutralizing guys as well. And you need a flinch support for double battles. Keep in mind that some of those requirements are actually very optional, but I will talk about it whenever we get to the team section. And that's basically all you need. It sounds like a lot, but keep in mind that, again, some of them are optional and that you can fuse Pokémon together. So you can have one Pokémon be your flinch and runaway Pokémon at the same time, for example. Everything starts in the starter's selection screen. So what do we get to start our run? My best advice is to go for the first strategy, which is to bring one legendary Pokémon that can carry you all the way to the highest wave. The best legendaries like Groudon or Kyogre can actually carry you all the way to floor 2000. And this is just an example here. So we have one of those legendaries, Kyurem, Groudon, Kyogre, Mewtwo, Zacian, Zekrom, Reshiram. Those can work too. We have a mix of shinies with some utilities. So you can bring Rattata, for example. It is a runaway Pokémon. And I would suggest if you are going to place all your strat on a legendary Pokémon, you are better off taking the Poképus of the day as well. You can wait for a one-cost Poképus. We had one yesterday, it was Paras, but it was a pretty good moment to go for it. The second strategy is the one that I'm using. It is to take some utility Pokémons and low-cost cores, basically to make a team as your start, using a mix of shinies that you have that also have utilities, and then make a splice carry. So let me explain. You want to make something that's very strong past floor 100. It relies less on RNG overall, I would say, even though it doesn't really matter. You're gonna find those Pokémon at the end of the day. Don't worry too much. You will have a hard time in those first 100 floors, especially since we are skipping on the Poképus for more utilities. You can even make fusion of two low-cost Pokémon. I made a fusion of Tinkaton and Rookidee. So I had the two of them at a two cost. So it was a four cost Pokémon. That's actually my current carry. I saw someone use Ralts, which is a one cost with reduction, and Lunatone that had Lumina Crash as an egg move. So you can merge them together. And at the end of the day, you have a Gardevoir with a pretty powerful egg move. So there is a lot of possibilities for starters if you take fusion into consideration, of course. And you can actually watch my video on the introduction of my journey to 5850 to check the team that I'm using for starters. So most of the time, I would say that it is better to get a legendary and load your team up with shinies and utilities than catch things as you go. It is way easier. If you find a splicer early and you don't really need one, you can feel free to merge your luck fillers so people have the rock shinies. They actually give 3 luck points. Those are gonna give you a lot of luck into your shop. So let me explain how luck works. So shinies in this game are more than just cosmetic. If you have a shiny Pokemon in your party that's not dead, very important, not dead, then they are going to adjust your odds at tearing up item in the shop. So those are the items at the bottom, not the top, of course, because the top is the shop and the bottom is going to be your dropped item. You have some kind of luck grade at the top right during the shop round. So it says like luck D, luck C, C minus, B minus, S, S minus, or stuff like this. So regular shinies are gonna give you 1 point, your luck. Rare shinies are gonna give you 2 points. And rogue shinies, so the red ones, they're gonna give you 3 points to luck. So the highest luck you can have is 14 points, which is triple S. It is actually insane. There is the table over there on the screen if you want to check. The odds of tearing up is based on those luck points. And if you merge 2 Pokemon together, so if you merge 2 rogue shinies together, you have 6 luck points. So again, having those shinies, it is pretty important. But if it is your first endless run after your first classic run, then you're not gonna have a lot of shinies or any rare shinies or rogue shinies. So don't worry too much about it. Just try to bring some shinies and capture them as you go, right? If you have a slot, bring a shiny. All right, so now that we have some kind of team, right, we are gonna talk about item. There is a huge amount of them, and the main reason we stack shinies is simply to start getting the good stuff as soon as possible. Items we want to have are the following. We want the candy jars that can stack up to 99, amulet coin stack up to 5, berry pouch stacking up to 3, lock capsule. So those are the ones that have an effect on the game in general. Now you want to stack specific held items as well. So stuff like leftovers, golden punch for money and amulet coin that they are working together. We have King's Rock if you want to have some kind of flinching strat. We have Grip Claw to stall the item that can be very useful. We will see that later on. We have Multi-Lens, Suldu for the nature, Wide Lens for accuracy moves if you need some. So if you're using some kind of Blizzard strat, we have type boosting items. So those are always important. And of course, we have proteins. The biggest priority among all of those, I would say, is probably candy jars for the level up on your main Pokemon above the leveling cap each floor. You have amulet coins and golden punch to make money and reroll your shop multiple times. And of course, you can always lock your rarities with the lock capsule. So the lock capsule is also very needed. Of course, don't forget that you can transfer your items from your pickup Pokemon to your main from time to time or whenever you get some kind of type boost item or if you're getting into a very important fight. Do not forget about transferring your item. In that scenario, since we are playing with a fusion of Tinkaton and Corviknight, whenever we get a Lucky / Golden Egg or a Silk Scarf / Metal Coat item, we want to switch them instantly from the pickup Pokemon to the main carry. Okay, so now that we know what to look for in terms of items and Pokemons, it is time to talk about making a team as we go. For the first part of Endless, it entirely depends which routes you're going with. If you're going for a legendary and a bunch of shinies to increase your luck, then you can just roll your head until like 1.5k, 2k, and build the different Pokemon that are needed for the second part, so as you go. If you are going for the second strategy, which is to take some utility Pokemons and low-cost cores to make a strong carry past floor 100, you will have a hard time again in those first 100 floors, especially since we are skipping on the Pokeras. So as you guys may know, I'm currently doing the strats to reach 5850, and this is, if you're not gonna watch the other video for the journey, let me just do a recap. My strat from 1 to 2000 is going to stick to a strong 5 starter to pass the first 100 floors. So in this case, I use Suicune, I believe, So I'm gonna dodge all the annoying fights, so very strong electric types for example. Pass floor 100, I will switch to Tinkaton completely with the merge of Corviknight. So we have Tinkaton with huge power mixed with Corviknight that has Unnerve, very, very strong carry for the early part of the game. And when I meet a Pokemon that I need in the future, I will simply capture it. So in my current run, we are at floor 500, I believe. I already have my Splice, Tinkaton and Corviknight, and I am currently working on my Blissey, Garganacle, and King Gambit mix as well. So we have all the elements for the main two cores of the team. So early on in the video, I made a checklist for what we need for the second part of Endless, so from 2000 or 2500 all the way to the end, so let's say above 2k for this case here. And this is all the things that we need. I'm going to talk in details about why we need them and some kind of example for each of them. So at the end of the day, it is up to you to adapt yourself to the situation you are in, so you can be unlucky and not find those Pokemons, but again, it is very unlikely. Those are just going to be guidelines, don't take my word for granted. Also, I will give you more examples in the team showcase part of the video at the end. So the first Pokemon is going to be a Runaway. A Runaway Pokemon is someone with the ability Runaway that allows him to run away from any wild encounters. So for raw Pokemon outside of Fusion, your best bet is probably Raticate, since you can teach him Super Fang on top of having that ability. If you don't pick your Runaway Pokemon at the start, you can really take anything. But if it is going to be a starter like mine, pick a low-cost one, so like Rattata or Sentret, for example. Keep in mind that you don't need to keep your starter Pokemon. You can take his ability, then give it to another to have a some kind of multi-purpose Pokemon. Then we have a pickup Pokemon that will always be needed for the biggest part of the game, since it allows you to loot items like berries and boost items from wild encounters. This Pokemon can be anything. It can be as cheap as Zigzagoon, or a Pokemon that can have some utilities later like Pump Kaboo. So Pump Kaboo is going to evolve into Gourgeist that has Leech Seed and Worry Seed, so two useful abilities in our kit. Your pickup Pokemon will be replaced at some point, since we won't need those items like at the later stages of the game. Or again, you can splice it with another if you don't want to get rid of it. It is totally possible. After that, you need a terrain setter to use Misty Terrain. So Sleep can be annoying after a while, especially if you're using a Metal Burst slash Sturdy Strat, because you always go second, right? You actually need an immune to Sleep. So Misty Terrain is going to protect you from status conditions. I would suggest to add this specific move to an already existing Pokemon, like the one you're using for Salcure and Soak, for example. So those are what you could call important utility for your team, and it depends on what your team is, of course. If you play a Pokemon with the ability Purifying Salt that protects it from status conditions, you don't really need Misty Terrain. You can actually skip over it. But now, let's talk about the more optional utility for your team. So you have a flinch support for double battles. The Pokemon having flinch is most likely going to be the one that's fused with another. In my case, since I'm using Meowth as a pickup Pokemon, I also have Fake Out on it, so it can be nice. You really don't need a flinch support for the second part of Endless, since you will only fight double battles for the first like 2,000, 2,500 floors. After that, you can just skip over them for easier fights. This is probably when I will get rid of my Meowth for another Pokemon. No, just getting rid of my flinch and slash pickup Pokemon. After that, again, more optional, some kind of weather support if your Pokemon needs it, and in case of sand damage. Remember, at the end of the day, we are playing with Sturdy. We don't want that sand to finish us off. This one is absolutely not necessary, since you can run away from those fights if necessary. And finally, you might need some kind... This one is actually more on the mandatory side, I would say. You need some kind of ability manipulation with stuff like Entrainment, Skill Swap or Neutralizing Gas, just to remove those annoying abilities like Wonder Guard, Disguise, Terra Vault as well. I saw someone post a mix of Eternatus and Zekrom, which is actually incredibly annoying, because if you don't get rid of Terra Vault, it actually goes past abilities like Sturdy or even Wonderguard if you're using some kind of strat like this. Okay, we are now done with utilities. Let's talk about your core Pokémons. You need a Pokémon or a mix of Pokémons most of the time with those moves. So Salcure, Leech Seed, Soak, and Super Fang. Super Fang is actually not needed. Neither is Soak, to be honest, but you mainly need something like Salcure and Leech Seed. Residual damage are pretty nice for Pokémon that have a lot of HP. This is your best bet to deal with the highest Eternatus fights. Super Fang is gonna cut one of his health bar every single hit. Salcure takes 1/8 of his health each turn. It actually turns into 1/4 with Soak applied because it works better on water types. And of course, you have Leech Seed that takes 1/8 of his health and everything is gonna stack together. After that, you need some kind of wall or some Pokémon with Protect until the boss is dead. I see some people use Shedinja most of the time to have a wall against Eternatus, but there is of course other strats. This Pokémon is most of the time always going to be a mix of multiple other Pokémons. So Salcure is only available on Garganacle, for example. So you will need him to fuse with a Pokémon that has Leech Seed, like Gourgeist, for example, that we saw earlier. You can also mix 3 or 4 Pokémons into one by splicing and unsplicing. But again, more example just after this section. Finally, your main carry. You need a strong spliced Pokémon with Sturdy and some kind of move that deals damage based on the attack of the enemy or his level. You know, something like Metal Burst, Nightshade, Seismic Toss. And you need to build a mix of Pokémon around it. That's your new carry past the 2500 floors. To be honest, after that, it's getting quite difficult. Keep in mind that if you are playing Metal Burst, you want to go last always, so you need a minus speed nature and some Suldus as well to get to that, that minus one speed. That's the goal here. Okay, so before we go into the team, I actually want to explain the fusion mechanics. I feel like it's something that's useful to know. I'm assuming that most people know how it works, but let me just remind you how it actually works. So the base stats of the two Pokémons are going to be averaged. The moves, learn set, and items are going to be combined together. This is why you can actually make any Pokémon, because you can merge the learn sets. IVs and natures are coming from the first Pokémon. The first type is going to come from the first Pokémon. The second or only type comes from the second. Abilities come from the second Pokémon. The passive ability comes from the first. So just let me give you an example. I have a Tinkaton with a passive ability of huge power, right? And I can fuse it with a Corviknight that has an ability, not a passive ability, but an ability of Unnerve. And my Pokémon is going to be a merge of Tinkaton and Corviknight with a passive ability of huge power and an ability of Unnerve. And when you unsplice, the second Pokémon is never recovered. So when you want to make a Metal Burst Pokémon with my Blissey, I do Blissey, then I do King Gambit to get Metal Burst, I unsplice, I'm gonna lose King Gambit, and then I'm gonna remerge Blissey and Garganacle together to get my final fusion. So I'm gonna have Salcure, Protect, and Metal Burst. Okay, that's how it works. All right, so now that we know what we know and why we know it on each of those Pokémons and what we need to do, it is time to give you some complete team examples. So shout out to the PokéRock Discord, of course, for all of those Pokémon teams and information. Those teams are not mine. I will add their Discord name in the bottom left corner. All those teams can be found on the Discord server inside the threads of the Endless Grinding channel. I am currently creating a document with all of those information that I have, and I will put it as a comment on my stream and in the description for future reference. I'm always gonna complete this document, so if you want to check, right now it is a huge mess, to be honest, but later on it might be a bit better. So I will showcase three teams. Note that the Pokémon that you choose for those abilities can be different. Those are just examples on how the abilities are distributed for those specific teams and those specific users. We have the first team coming from UU8D. So his starter was Mark Shadow with no retreat, Drain Punch, and Shadow Punch for the first 1500 floors. He then added Nightshade and Seismic Toss and Salcure later to carry him to the higher floors. His Salcure, Leech Seed, Soak, and Protect Pokémon is a mix of two fusion Pokémons. So the first is a mix of Jumpluff and Shuckle with Leech Seed, Salcure. And the second is a mix of Gourgeist and Gigalith with Worry Seed for annoying abilities and Soak to amplify the Salt Cure. He used a wall for double battles and to tank Eternatus, so it is a mix of Mossholt and Shedinja, creating a normal slash ghost Wonder Guard with Population Bomb and Grip Claw to remove all its citrus berries. It has Rain Dance as well for a potential weather support. Rapidash was his runaway Pokémon, and he has a potential second carry using Latias and Bastiodon with Metal Burst, Nightshade, plus Roar for annoying double battles or before finding his runaway Pokémon. So the second team is coming from a brick to the head. Her starter was Mewtwo, that was later fused to gain Seismic Toss, then fused with Lumineon, I'm assuming, to get Soak. Her Salcure slash Leech Seed Pokémon was a mix of Gourgeist and Garganacle. The Soak is on her Mewtwo, just if you remember. Her pickup Pokémon was probably a Linoon, later mixed with a Groudon for luck points. Her Pokémon to swap abilities also use Super Fang, and it is a mix of Ribombee and something else. I'm not sure about this one, to be honest. And her wall for tougher fights was a mix of Regis and Cresselia, so having a special defense with Levitate. And finally, another potential second carry or a wall using Malamar and Shedinja. It is a dark slash ghost type with Nightshade, Salcure and Teeth to, I'm assuming, remove Eternatus berries. Finally, we have the third team from Dom, only using 4 Pokémons for the end of his run. His starter was a Reshiram that he later dropped. His main carry was a mix of Wobbuffet, Wormadam and Garganacle with Salcure, Metal Burst and Protect. His Leech Seed, Worry Seed and Soak Pokémon was a Prankster Whimsicott to run away and dot Eternatus. And he also had a Neutralizing Gas Breloom mixed with Weezing to help him run away and neutralize annoying abilities. And finally, his runaway Pokémon was a mix of Raticate and Mega Gengar. Alright, it was a pretty long video. It was a lot of work as well, so I hope you can like the video, subscribe, you know, do the thing, share the video. There is some niche stuff that I haven't talked about and I'm not gonna add into this video because this is mainly a entry guide into Endless. I might make a second guide more advanced for specific strats, but I think overall you have everything you need right now to go into your first Endless mod and start going at it and possibly finish your first run. Feel free to correct me in the comments, I'm pretty sure some of you have some things to say, and tell me about your team. Check my stream in the docs and I will be see you guys in the game or on my stream. I will be here for a while. See ya!